If you want to build a beautiful house for yourself, you're going to prepare the foundation and framing of the house first. These phases are the most crucial things and they're going to determine how you want to put your building blocks together. The exact thing happens in our body. The cells are the building blocks of your functional systems, your tissues and organs. Obviously, our tissues haven't been made with a single type of cells. In contrast, they consist of so many different cells that are specialized to do very specific jobs. But they cannot just make such complex structures out of nowhere without any instructions. For making a tissue, first our stem cells should proliferate, which means they should make more of themselves, and they should differentiate to other type of cells which are more specified to do various specific jobs. It's exactly like situations when a baby is born and through time he or she works hard to specialize to be a doctor or an engineer. Thousands and millions of those specialists should work together in an exact position to make functional tissues. And for doing that, the cells not only should communicate with other cells, but also they should gather both chemical and physical information from their environment too. Often a non-cellular structure can be found in our tissues, which we call extracellular matrix or ECM. The extracellular matrix has a very complex structure made of different components. Okay, wait. In my previous videos, I told you that the difference between scarring and regeneration is that in scarring, fibroblasts can be activated to produce extracellular matrix to the wound site and make a scar tissue. But that was just an oversimplification. In a less simplified way, fibroblast activates in both scarring and regeneration, but the composition and the amount of the extracellular matrix in a scar and normal tissue is completely different, which is a very complex topic and we need to talk about in details in different videos. But what is important here is that the extracellular matrix is like a frame of a house for tissues. It holds the instruction for our cells to make specific tissues and organs. Since different houses have different frames, different tissues have different ECM with different composition and structures. But why I'm telling you all this and what's the role of biomaterials here? Traditionally, we use biomaterial because of their mechanical functions for use in prosthetic and medical devices such as artificial hips or dental implants. And we tried to pick a material to not interact with the host biological system because we wanted to decrease the chance of rejections by the host immune system. But now with improving different technologies, we are able to design biomaterials to mimic the physical and chemical cues that our stem cells need to make specific tissues. But how we can do that, and which properties we should pay attention to? Until now, we have been talking about that if an injury happens in our body, the cells that died in our tissue should replace with new ones, which we call this process regeneration. But as we talked about it before, we are not good at regeneration, and for some reason, our body makes scar tissues in most injuries, which brings a lot of complications. We know that our specialized cells or fully differentiated cells can divide to make new cells, but we found that most of our tissues have a niche for stem cells which can proliferate to make more of them, and they can differentiate into specialized cells. We started developing technique to isolate those stem cells from our tissues, and we started culturing them in the lab to make more of them. So we can inject those stem cells directly into the sites of injury, which we call cell transplantation. But it doesn't work quite well. Here's why. The stem cells need to proliferate and differentiate into cells which are dead during injury. And they need to know the exact position and time to do all of those things. For doing that, they need appropriate instructions which they learn from three factors. The chemical signals which are produced by different cells such as damaged cells and immune cells, the direct interactions of our cells together which we call cell-cell interactions, and the other one is the direct interactions of our cells with their extracellular matrix which we call cell matrix interaction. In cell transplantation, we have cell-cell interactions, but we eliminate signaling molecules and cell matrix interaction. For solving the signaling part, we can add signaling molecules ourselves, and for cell matrix interaction, we can make a temporary substrate for our cells, which we call a scaffold, to provide a suitable environment for them. And obviously, we use biomaterials to make our scaffold. But not all scaffolds and biomaterials are favorable for our cells. Our cells are really strict and picky about their environment. After considering a variety of factors, they can change their behaviors. What I mean by behavior is that they can run away or they can move towards and attach to the scaffold. They can proliferate and differentiate into different cells, and they can signal to other cells to do the same thing. So what are those factors and how they can affect the behavior of our cells? Let's imagine that you want to build a scaffold in the lab. First, you need to consider which biomaterial you can use. There are a lot of options and all of them have their own pros and cons. We can extract biomaterials from natural resources like plants, animals, or even humans. For example, gelatin is one of those biomaterials which can be extracted from animals like fish, chicken, or cattle, and surprisingly, it's the same gelatin that we use as an ingredient in our food. We can use synthetic biomaterials as well, like ceramics or many polymers that we can make in the lab with different chemical techniques. But we should consider that every biomaterial gives your scaffold different properties. At first, we need our cells to move towards our biomaterial and attach to it. So we need to pick a hydrophilic biomaterial. Hydrophilic means how much our biomaterials can attract water, and we can measure this in the lab by putting a droplet of water on the biomaterial surface. If it is less than 90 degrees, we consider the biomaterial hydrophilic, and our cells love hydrophilic surface. But the attachment of our cells to the surface of biomaterials gives them a 2D environment. But the reality is that our tissue and organs have 3D structures. So we need to design a lot of pores in our biomaterials, so our cells can go inside the biomaterials and make it 3D structures. And that's the reason the size of the pores is very crucial, because different cells have different sizes, so their desire is different. Some prefer small pores, but others prefer the big ones. Even the number of pores is really important. For example, in a study by Ma and colleagues, they found that low porosity, about 30%, with a size of 0.84 micrometers, can promote metabolic activity and the rate of cell proliferation. But 39 porosity with the size of 0.9 micrometer showed higher level of cell aggregation and differentiation. This is a picture of a biomaterial that was taken by a scanning electron microscopy, or SEM, which I'm not going through the details, but it suffices to say that you can see the fibrous structures of the biomaterial, and actually you can see the cells in here. Let me zoom a little bit. You can see the cell is completely attached to the biomaterial and is happy, like really happy. If you want to design a biomaterial, its mechanical properties are very important. The mechanical properties of every tissue are different, and it guides shape, morphology, and behavior of the stem cells as well. That's one of the reasons most scientists advise designing a scaffold that mimics the mechanical features of our native tissues. For example, the Young modulus is a mechanical property that measures the tensile or compressive stiffness of a material. The lower the Young modulus indicates that our material is more elastic. For example, water has a zero Young modulus, which is very soft and deformed without force. But conversely, a rigid material has a higher Young modulus. In the case of biomaterials, different Young modulus can mean different things for different cells. For example, the stem cells in our neural tissue, which we call neural stem cells, start proliferating with 3.5 kilopascal, but they differentiate into neurons and softer materials with a stiffness less than 1 kilopascal. Besides mechanical properties, cells can respond to the topographical structure of the biomaterial surface, and they can modulate their alignment and orientation along the surface. By topography, I mean forms and features of the surface of the biomaterial. For example, it can be a rough or smooth surface, or it can have different patterns. For example, we can culture stem cells on a random topology like this, or we can culture them on aligned fibers. Look how the same cell has different shapes and sizes on the same biomaterial, but a different surface pattern. The first one, which was cultured on the random surface, differentiated to bone cells, but the stem cells on the aligned fibers differentiated to tendon cells. As the saying goes, every answer leads to more questions. We still don't know the exact interactions between different materials with different cells. We don't know what exact signaling pathways are activated when we introduce a specific biomaterial to the body. And when we add those interactions to the relationship between our immune system and regeneration, the complexity reaches the highest. But we're still trying and dig into the detail to learn more about them, and finally we crack the code behind regeneration.